the infrastructure and services for the youth in the local area. And we'd also like them to take into account that a lot of what might be available is out of the means or out of the, should we say, the spendability of families in the local area. So we do need services that are affordable. I think it's fair to say that.
On to the next question.
Ellen? Yeah, please, yeah.
It's connected to police and youth and the young people and children. I'd just like to shift things a little bit and maybe ask the panel, how much inputs do they think they should make to actual education of children to be more community-minded? And because you'll get a group of children together, and they may be so opposed to adults, etc., that it will be very difficult for them to progress, you know, as a community. So I'm wondering, you know, actually in school, how much there is of teaching or things could be, you know, good behavior or those types of things, because we're finding more and more children particularly unruly at very, very young ages, and I'm wondering if perhaps we should be looking at how people are being taught.
Starts at home, doesn't it? Not at home.
Yeah, no, thank you for that. One of the pledges that we made was that we would not build on the green belt, and that's one that we would hold throughout our town. I know the question was about metropolitan land that generally has the same status as green belt. In terms of the education side of it, I think that what you're talking about is a complex set of issues which present themselves in young people who have behavioural problems and so on. And it does, unfortunately, and I don't want to repeat myself, goes back to an earlier point, which is that there are a whole series of services and support services that local authorities used to be able to run, but you know, in the last 7 years with the coalition government and now the current government, about 40% of budgets have been taken out of local authorities, and they are generally struggling to provide some of these services. So youth service would be one, you know, childcare, a whole range of services, the probation service, which present as a multitude of complex problems, which then present as children who are having behavioural problems. And so, in a sense, you know, we have got some policies around childcare, around education, that would help and support that. But what we really need, we think, is a Labour government that would invest in our public services and would be able to reinvest in local government, in social care, and all the support services which go to help to catch these children who perhaps have not got the benefit of two parents and so on, and have got, not got the benefit of a stable home environment.
Yes, no, maybe,
not yet.
Actually reminded me that 16 years ago the Labour Council did actually start the whole privatisation, and the Conservative Party just sort of ran with it. So now I think that you actually should remember. Of the services in Barnet was actually started by the Labour Council at the time, in 2002. Yeah, 16 years ago?
Administration.
I see. Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you so much. As for the children, and the things that I would actually like to... Okay, the Green Party, the most we did actually with the schools is actually tested the air pollutions.
because we were actually allowed inside, but we tested the air pollution outside and we found out that all the machines were breaking EU regulations, so we didn't form the schools. As for activities, it would actually be nice. I mean, I don't know if there are any Boy Scouts in there. I know that they're actually sort of running out now. They can't get the Scout Masters anymore. But it would be nice to actually get people more activities for children. She said they're getting unruly. We have a high obesity rate in the country. It would be nice to actually get them outside and playing, even football, or just activities. It would actually be better for them as well when they leave schools. I don't know if actually that, again, that's where the community centers come in. They might not be interested in schools, but then outside of it, they might actually be interested in actually learning all these things. That's all I can actually say. Yes, 1 minute for a second. Thank you.
I think this is a really difficult question because there clearly are problems and finding solutions to them have been proved to be really, really difficult. There is recent policy which has been put forward for exactly, I think, as you said, for schools to provide more out-of-hours provision for children to try and provide some more structured environment for them to avoid some of the difficulties that then arise when they don't have any structured environment out of hours. Resources are clearly enormously difficult with the pressures on all local authorities. So I think that this is absolutely a really difficult issue. I can't claim that we in any way have good solutions to the problem, but it is something which is being worked on, and I think it's being worked on because it's not just a Charles Hill problem, it's a national problem, and I think all parties actually struggle, despite whatever people may say, all parties struggle with finding good solutions. But it's clear we have a lot of school governors in the room, and it is clear that the schools do have a really important part to play in this. Thank you.
Madam, I'm going to gently disagree with you. I've been a governor of St Agnes's Roman Catholic Primary School down in Thornton Road for 30 odd years, and they do some wonderful work with their children.
Sorry, what type of school?
Roman Catholic Agnes. Primary school. They do wonderful work with the children in the community. And I know Charles Hill School does, because I visited them often, and I'm sure Swedish does as well. I'm a bit worried about raising the follow-up to that, because last time I did, everyone wanted to debate it. That's about school funding. Now, I chair the finance committee, and fortunately at St Agnes's, we have a huge contingency. But the budget for next year is actually running at a deficit. And if we continue with the lack of funds we have, we're going to run out of money. And when a school runs out of money, the first thing they have to do is lay off teachers. And that's for all schools. So there's a funding problem. Yeah? And it's a real time bomb that keeps on ticking about school funding. That might widen it out a bit. Now, Madam, I haven't forgotten your point. About the new build, and I can't disagree with you. I'm going to make a statement, I'm not going to follow it up, and you can make your own mind up about this. A few months ago, have you heard about the aggregates planning application down at Picklewood? That was on the agenda of the planning committee. Everybody turned up, yeah, protested, local council spoke against it. But the Conservative dominated planning committee voted to approve it. On the same night, there was a planning application that followed immediately after that for flats and houses, flats mainly, on the old Barner House up in Whetstone. A tall building, recommended for approval, that was refused. Let them be home. Think about it. Why did it?
Thank you, Kat.
So, can I just do a little comment? Obviously, it's not for further discussion, no doubt, I think. But I think there was a slight misunderstanding of the nature of my question. It was actually between school hours what children are actually taught in terms of, you know, you may call it citizenship, you may call it good neighborliness. We would say the basics of the Bible, the Ten Commandments, that type of thing is that, you know, I think it's important for children to talk to basics because they seem to be unimportant, but they are very important in the way children have an outlook on life.
Thank you, I have to agree with you. I think a lot of the children are a bit disenchanted and what we find is they become disengaged and inevitably become unruly. But you're right, there should be a sense of community engagement, care for the community where they live, care for elders in general, care for themselves. But yeah, it's something to look at.
It's basically saying, teach your children the way you should go, on the right path. You know, when I lived with my grandparents, she didn't go to church or anything, but she taught me the right way. I'm Christian, yes. And she taught me the right way.
Yeah, I think as far as...
Do you understand what I'm saying?
I do understand, but obviously I think a lot of parents do teach their kids the right way. I think it's more a case of society and a lot of things that we can't even think about. But the gentleman at the back, your turn.
The councillors who are in office at the moment and the councillors who may be elected next month, do you actually have a real power? Because it is a toss-up between central government and local government. And central government always dictates what local government should do. No name mentioned, there is one gentleman on the panel who tried to help me when I had my accident last year. Part of council dismissed him like that. So do you actually have any power to change or make things happen? Because it is always a toss-up between central government, local government, and central government always wins.
Thank you very much. I think I know who you're talking about. Thank you. So you're right about central government, because they're the ones that dictate how much money the authorities get. So if money is tight, local authorities have to find the money from somewhere. And actually the council tax. But there are complicated rules about how you can raise money for council tax. And if you can't raise enough money, it means services are cut. So that's a central government. Now, Barbara Holmes is a kind of, I don't know, it's kind of...
They are a private company.
Yeah, it's arm's length, thank you very much.
Almada,
musical arm's length. But you're right. We don't seem to have so much influence at Barnett Homes as we used to. And you know from your personal experiences, we try. I think you make a very good point. Thank you very much.
Thank
you.
Well,
next door.
I need to give them. Take off please step six or so they can respond to your question. Thank you.
Jack's been here for a very long time. Councillor Ryan and I have only been here for 4 years. So we've been learning how to get the council to do what we need to happen in Charles Hill. And when you're dealing with any large organisation, you have to learn how it works. As with all large organisations, it's actually about the people there and getting to know the people
and working out what the processes you have to go through to get the people to do what you want. You may remember in my introduction, I mentioned that I had actually brought officers down to Charles Hill to walk around this area. And every single one of them I brought down here, I've walked through this estate because I wanted them to understand what the development was all about, that this was a very nice estate, it was a very well-ordered estate, and that the loss of green space, even though it may seem on an aerial photograph as if it wasn't used much, was actually very important to the local environment. And I think that by doing that and by getting them down here and by developing relationships with people, that is the only way that you can get organisations to do what you want. And we have invested an enormous amount of time in getting to know the... From today, I was in the high street and I was with the guy with the new cleaning machine who's actually cleaning Golders Green High Street, which is actually miraculously looking better than it has for a very long time because he's now got a cleaning machine that allows him to actually clean. Which you may say, how did it take so long? Well, actually, in local authority land, it takes a long time to do anything. So the answer to your question, sir, the answer to your question, sir, is yes, you can do stuff locally, but you have to put the effort in to get to know the people, so that when you ask for something, they will do it for you if they're allowed to do it.
I was going to start. You mentioned your offices. Are you police officers or are you a councillor?
Thank you for the question. Certainly, having met with people locally and having gone through the process of getting elected, I think we certainly hope that at the end of it we will be able to make a difference. But I suppose one of the things we want to do is, having got to the point of a Labour administration, is actually try and give away some of that power and give it to the people here in this room. And we are looking at doing a variety of different things, like setting priorities with the community, and also opening up to question time for full council meetings, involving and engaging people in the process of democracy. Because I think there are a number of things that local authorities can do, and yes, we have to take our settlement and our framework from central government, but there are many things that we do in terms of house building, in terms of planning decisions, in terms of social care, in terms of youth services or not, as the case may be. So there are a huge range of things that the local authority can do to make a difference. And I think we would like to take our cue from the manifesto that we set out, but also our discussions with you as a community, so that you actually feel that you're empowered to influence the way in which policy is developed over the coming 4 years.
Well, you can get, David Cameron, Grace Mayer, all sorts. Can you get a picture of Richard Cornelius on
Acrobat? That's what we're trying to do,
yeah.
The one about Richard Cornelius, you wanted to ask Dan Thomas about that. As for the central government or council, I mean, put it this way, back in 2014, there was hardly any mention about the environment because the Greens are here, and we only have four councillors in the whole of London. Everyone actually has mentioned the environment, like the green belt or plastic. That is actually the power. We do speak truth to power. That's actually our job. We might not be able to have as much influence as we would like, but we are there in the background telling people, no, you need to actually do this. So we said, build more council housing. So now they actually is in the manifesto for the Labour Party now, which is actually quite good. The same thing with renationalizing railways, which was actually in the Green Party manifesto, that turned up in the that turned out the Labour manifesto. We just hope that actually land value tax and the universal basic income. Excuse me. No, it's actually that the Labour Party did actually give it up back in 1997 to 2010. So,
yes. We don't want to do three things.
Sorry. It's just that I only have about 45 seconds. I'm just pointing out this. Actually, I did come to the Green Party as a political activist. I was actually out there on the streets, and I did find actually that is quite effective as well in changing people, government's minds. and this is actually an extension of it. I, as a Green Party member, I am not actually controlled by the Green Party, which is actually quite good, because most of my political activism is actually supported by the Green Party. Karen Lucas did actually get arrested a few years ago. That's the reason why I actually joined, because I've been arrested twice by the police as well. So one is it was an anti-BNP demo, the second time was for a pro-democracy demo in London Square. So,
Green Party,
thank you.
But it takes more than to make a
gentlemen,
just to close with you. I want to get to the next of the council again, where they control HMOs, which has been a big issue around in the area. There's only been one council who's actually been doing something, been very helpful pushing it on its own. We've had HMOs springing up, and I emailed the Conservatives a couple of weeks ago to mention in their newsletter that they basically haven't been dealing with them. Unfortunately, I've never had a reply. I asked him when I asked about enforcement that's going on in our road and also the other HMOs that were springing up.
So, who helped you?
Councillor
Cohen. Yes, I'm sure Councillor Cohen did an excellent job because he always does.
Yeah.
But on HMOs, I think it's only fair if I tell you the following. First of all, Councillor Ride is the one who introduced the motion at Council to bring HMOs fully within the planning system. Because prior to his motion, HMOs of less than five or less people did not require any planning approval, whereas all HMOs now do require planning approval. And in relation to planning enforcement, I think it is one of the things which I can say that I personally spent a great deal of time with the planning team trying to make better. And for the last year, Councillor Ryde and I have sat down with the council planning enforcers every month, going over every single complaint that has been received by planning enforcement to make sure that we know exactly what they are doing and that appropriate diligence is being applied to each of the issues. And I can tell you that, unfortunately, planning powers are not absolute, but a number of HMO issues are being taken, and beds and sheds issues are being taken through the courts as we speak. And the council is now one of the most active planning enforcers. I know this isn't going to change how you vote, sir, but all I can tell you is that we have invested a huge amount of our time in trying to make sure that the council accurately and properly prosecutes illegal HMOs, controls HMOs, and in general, we have made sure that all HMO decisions are not taken by planning officers, but are actually brought to committee so that councillors have a chance to review them and decide whether they are appropriate. So we take this deadly seriously. Thank you.
Picking out roads and they're still operating without licence, despite Barnet being told that they're operating. One is a two bedroom house that's got five bed sits in, one had nine bed sits in. There's no building control, there's a fire. And there's various issues that I won't go into, but we've actually seen in, and also the police have been called a few times to some of these HMOs to the beds that the trans in population.
As I said, sir, the council doesn't have infinite powers in this area, but every single one of the ones that's been reported to us, and there's about 200 items on the enforcement list in Charles Hill alone, and we go over them between every 3 weeks and every 4 weeks with planning officers.
Okay, so
I've
reported
nothing is done.
This is a critical issue. The amount of affordable housing that we have is going down. Obviously, the right to buy and the fact that we're redeveloping and not replacing council houses in many cases. And we have seen the growth of rogue landlords in the borough. And we have a policy to introduce licensing for that. And we've seen in other boroughs that this can work. That we can actually, you know, the unlicensed tendencies are places where you quite often see antisocial behaviour and all kinds of related problems. And through a licensing policy, we can actually change that. And in fact, generate council tax, because a lot of these people are not actually paying council tax as well. So, you know, there's a huge amount that we can actually do. For example, Newham have been doing a huge amount of work in this area. And we could be looking at their model, not necessarily following its legislation, but looking at their model and introducing that here so that we can tackle the HMOs where they already exist, enforce more rigorously, and also, you know, challenge these more at the planning application stage. But once they are already established, and many are, we need to be developing a licensing system so we can get this under control, and we can bring a decent housing to the private sector, the private renting sector, which for many people now is their only option for housing.
Okay, not some others around you want to stop this before I start. If they were in the HMOs, they have to go ahead and stop them. But unfortunately, Barnet and Pierce allowed them actually being better built and constructed, and then said, oh, yes, that is an HMO, it's like being a negative force, but the lack of enforcement has been a problem in the past where it hasn't gone through the laws, and hopes have gone away, and it hasn't.
Yes, sorry. The question that was asked for me the last hustings, was how many empty houses there are in Barnet. We only have figures from 2011, which was 3,400. Walking around my areas that I've actually been to, there's always houses that have basically been land banked. I've seen one house that's actually 20 years old. 20 years old and it's been empty for that long. And figures are the last 4 years, Barnet Council did give £4 million to private landlords as incentives in order to actually renovate their houses and then rent it out to the council to private rent. That's about, the last year was 379 landlords, £1.6 million. That's just £25,000 to £38,000 each, just for them to renovate their house. And the council doesn't really get anything out of it apart from somebody to get. And yeah, you do have private landlords making a lot of money out of this, unfortunately. I would like to investigate the powers of the council to take over. If a house has been long-term empty, there are powers for the council to actually take over that compulsory purchase order, which has been done on people in West Hendon, after all, which the council can do on these empty houses and then take it back under control of the council, or buy it outright, renovate it, and then rent it out, which is actually better. And perhaps upon it, private renters union in just for Barnet would actually be useful for us, because it's actually affordable housing is actually a joke. It's not affordable, affordable to some people, not affordable to most people in Barnet. And we do have a council which says that if you can't afford to live in Barnet, we don't want you here. And that's actually from the a colleague of the Conservative councillor. Thank you.
At the last council meeting, I asked the council meeting why Barnet hadn't yet signed up to their own landlord register, which most boroughs have. He gave a kind of half response, but said they intend to. And so at this moment in time, I don't know whether Barnet has yet signed up to it. It's a real problem in Barnet, the number of HMOs. And it's frustrating that the council, point you make, sir, that doesn't act fast enough. And I just want to have a little caveat there. HMOs in some localities, there's nothing wrong with that, because you can provide accommodation for students and young people. At what should be a decent rent, unfortunately, these rogue landlords, A, don't provide it at a decent rent, and B, the living conditions are poor. So there is space for HMOs, but Charles Hill seems to be a magnet for some reason. And could it be that they see Barnet as a soft touch? Don't know. And that they think they can get away with it. To be fair to Councillor Zimkin, Barnet did do something about their enforcement department, because it was actually a meltdown. It took a long time. It took opposition councillors and administrative administration councillors to kick up a fuss if something was done about it. I still don't think it's strong enough. I think there's a lot more to do. And the secret is to get in before the HMO is established. Because once it's established, let's say it goes to appeal, who refuses it? Planning inspectors are very reluctant to close something down that has people living there as their homes. By the time it gets to that stage, it's very, very difficult. So more action is needed, more officers are needed. I proposed that in one of my budgets to the council, which rejected out of hand. But it's a real problem, and you're right to raise it, and you're right to be concerned about it.
Thank you. Before going out to the floor again, I think I'll just put a question forward for GERA, which represents the Residents Association on the ground of the state. I know many of you have spoken about our dilemma regarding our fouled appeal. However, what we'd like as a residents association, and I'm sure many residents on the estate would like to know, is what would you do if the opportunity were there for you to reconsider the plans that have been put forward by the developers? And this question comes on the back of some questions that have already been put forward regarding the youth, green space, but there are other issues as well that we feel quite strongly about, and apart from the community centre, the fact that the possibility of losing green space, the fact that there's going to be a road running right through the estate, the fact that there's no storage for 180 flats in tower blocks. Those are just a few of the things that come to mind, but we'd just like to know what sort of plans you would have for us if you were sort of to become a representative of Charles Hill.
I think there's a terrible lack of communication that was outlined at the beginning. I mean, I didn't even know that the earth was going through. Now, this is the next road, it's only by word now.
The cynical OB will tell you that the applicant's likely to come back with an amended plan. They always do, so there's an opportunity there to try and influence them. I just want to give you an example of what's happening down in Donoghue's, where we've struggled for years against the blight of noise and dust. And we all have now got together, cross-party, with the residents. And we have regular meetings with the environment agencies, officers, planning officers, highway officers. And it's made a huge difference. So here's a simple, cost-effective solution to the dilemma you're proposing. You put forward. Is why not set up, if I'm re-elected, this is something I want to do as a priority, the same kind of cross-party, cross-departmental, don't call a committee, it's an ad hoc meeting, right? That can look at how the development is going, yeah? Because as part of the development, there's loads of conditions, yeah? Some of them are called reserve matters, which haven't been determined yet. So each time those conditions come up, reserve matters come up, we meet as a community directly with officers. Now, I'm down to council thinking council might meet with officers. Great. Even better if the residents met with officers, isn't it? Yeah. So you can talk to them directly. Because you know, sometimes when I speak to officers or email them, I think they think it's me making it up, you know. But I'm not, I'm speaking on behalf of them. So a very simple starting point is have some kind of working group that has councillors on, has senior officers on. Can't force officers to do things. We can make life uncomfortable for them as we have done with Donoghue's, and things will start to get done. So there's a start of it.
Broadly, I not only agree with Councillor Cohen on this,
but have already suggested to officers that we should do something exactly like that. The difficulty is that the developer was not very interested in engaging, which was very disappointing. However, there will be a moment when the developer needs something, and that is the moment when you have our absolute assurance we will take full advantage of that to get exactly what Councillor Cohen has suggested, and in an ideal world, somewhat less houses in the development as well, so there is more green space preserved. We have a very clear view, this is overdevelopment. We have a very clear view about what we would do to adjust the development to create some more green space. We are waiting for the moment when the developer needs something for us, and we have made it completely clear to officers that at that moment we expect them to take advantage of what the developer needs and to try and make things better. And we will absolutely do that, no question. And I think that, as I said, we think that the sort of working group that we put together for Donoghue's, which has worked very well and has started to make some progress there, is exactly the sort of thing we need for this community when the development starts. And in fact, a year ago, we talked to officers about doing exactly that, we talked to Anthony as well, of course, because that is exactly what this community needs, and the surrounding streets as well, because it's going to be a very disruptive development for quite a long period of time. And unless there are satisfactory arrangements, we will have real problems. So I think there is unanimity of view, which is what you'd expect, against something which is going to be solved by a cross-party and resident group.
So when our arts, they're moving out of the Donoghue's, where are they moving?
Can we take Donoghue's as a separate question? Because it's just a long story. But yes, absolutely, that's the only answer that Donoghue's to move. Completely agree.
Well, the question's in two parts, in a sense, what we can do and what we would have done if we could start again. I mean, our policies on how to start a regeneration programme are very clear. We start with you, we start with the community, we talk to you about what your aspirations are for your area, and we start the process there. Most people understand that development may have to take place, but they understand and want for that development to take place in a way which still preserves key routeways, still preserves green space, perhaps rebuilds a community centre, and doesn't take away their storage. I think if we're looking at this again, and we get the opportunity to look at it again, if the developer has to come back, then we will want to do the same thing. We will want to engage with you in terms of the things that you would like to see happening on this site. And I suspect the list I just read out will be fairly high on your priorities. But this has been a real tale of woe. And you know, I had a look at the planning application, and there's this thing which is called community infrastructure lending, which is where the developer has to pay money based on how much additional accommodation they are providing. And you know what they actually did? They actually took the pram sheds that they're taking away from you, and they subtracted it from the amount of money that they're having to pay the council. It's really just dreadful. And you know, this is the kind of thing that we need to tackle in terms of the planning situation, being strong and tough in planning, looking very closely at the economic viability and making sure that we're not having the wool pulled over our eyes, but also coming back, as I said, at the very beginning, making sure that the community are involved and making sure that we actually build additional, genuinely affordable homes for the community.
Also, parking. We have a parking issue up here. Are they going to have underground parking?